Hello, friends. This is Christian Connections live from LLBN Studio One. We'd like to welcome our viewers in the United States, Canada, and the rest of the world. And I want to say we're so delighted to rejoin you for our first live for the year of 2017. We have a great group of people with us today. We're going to have lots of conversation. We'll never be short on material. But before we go any further, I want to share with you, our viewers, our constituents, that in 2016, well, December 2016, we made an appeal for $260,000. And I want to report to you that our financial statements were closed last week and reflected that we have met the $260,000 plus much more. So we really want to thank you for that love and giving you given to this ministry of Jesus and for blessing millions around the world to be able to receive LLBN. Hannah and Marlon, join us for those two programs. Hannah, what was the first one?
Evidence of our faith. We had Pastor Jim Ayers lead us in a great sharing on evidences of faith that we have today.
Marlon, do you remember the second program?
Of course, Gift of God. Yeah. What a great series. I want to thank you all for your participation. It's you that made this program such a success, and we loved doing it for you. In fact, maybe we should do some more. What do you think, Adam?
Well, it's in the plans. We're doing more, and we will look forward to share that with you in the few upcoming months as we roll out our 2017 programming lineup. Marlon, you have guests today. Would you like to introduce them?
Yes, I'll tell you what. This subject is a real deep subject. It's a sensitive subject. It is a subject of celebration, of joy, but it has a modicum of sadness attached to it. This subject is Dietrich Bonhoeffer. Now, many of you know that name, and many of you are going to know that name because this coming Sabbath, there is going to be a special presentation on the life and times and the work of Dietrich Bonhoeffer right here, live from University Church. Get him?
Thank you. We look forward to that discussion. Hannah, you also have music planned today.
I do. I have an accomplished oboist, Edino Biagi, and he'll be sharing with us his musical talents today.
Excellent. Last but not least, my guest for the day, Chef Mark Anthony. No stranger to some of our viewers who watch Smart Lifestyle TV. I believe you're also on other Adventist networks and probably other television networks as well.
Yeah, good to be here. Thanks for having me.
Good to have you. What would your topic of discussion or what's your sermon would be about today?
Mostly what I like to do is just inspire and motivate people.
Okay.
Get people excited about serving the Lord.
So it's not going to be about cooking or recipes.
Yeah, no.
Recipes of faith.
I'm going to kick it up a notch today.
Recipes of faith. Wonderful. Well, Marlon, we'll go back to you to introduce your guests and take it from here.
Well, this is going to be an open conversation. So after we get started, I want to make sure that you guys have the opportunity to talk to our special guests, and these people, you know, really know what they're talking about when it comes to Dietrich Bonhoeffer. Jeff Gang is a PhD, I believe, and he is working on a dissertation about the life and times of Dietrich Bonhoeffer. And we have the director, Kevin Ekvall, with us as well. He's the one that is going to make the presentation that we're all looking forward to seeing from University Church live this Sabbath, and of course, last Sabbath, if this is playing before the other Sabbath. But welcome, Jeff and Kevin.
Thank you.
To Christian Connections. And we're going to start off with Jeff. Tell us a little bit about the life and times of Dietrich Bonhoeffer. Who was he? Where did he come from, and what did he do?
Dietrich Bonhoeffer was a Lutheran theologian and pastor that came of age during the rise of Nazi Germany. He was a part of the Confessing Church, which was a group of Christians in Germany that stood up to the Nazification of the German church. And also started an illegal seminary in Finkenwalde, Germany, for a preacher's seminary for young men that were a part of that confessing church.
You said illegal seminary.
Yeah, it was an illegal seminary that, because you had to be organized within the German state, and if you weren't a part of that, it was illegal.
So it's like an underground.
It was kind of an underground seminary, yeah. Mm-hmm. And he had an incredible community there that they experienced together. It was eventually closed down by the Gestapo, and Bonhoeffer then joined the resistance eventually against Hitler, and was arrested at one point, was in prison for over 18 months in Berlin, and then transferred to the Buchenwalde concentration camp, and eventually ended up at Flossenbürg concentration camp, where he was executed just days before the end of the war.
And all for what? What did he do?
He was accused of being part of the resistance against Hitler, and he was, you know, that's the big question. And this film looks at is what was his role in that, in the conspiracy against of Hitler.
Now, Kevin, how do you tell that story that Jeff just mentioned?
Yeah, it's a good question. There's been a number of different books, quite a few books written about him, and several films. Our film just takes a look at the last few months of his life. So we're just looking at the very end. And we chose to tell the story in kind of a unique way, where we actually are looking at it from a British intelligence radio propaganda team, and they're broadcasting into Germany, and they learn about this resistance, this German resistance, and specifically about Dietrich Bonhoeffer. So we kind of use that vantage point to then go back and forth and see Dietrich in that journey from Tegel prison to the Gestapo prison, to Buchenwald, and then to Flossenbürg.
Yeah. Well, let's give our audience a flavor of what they're going to enjoy as part of the Vespers special. We have some video from this project here for you, right here on Christian Connections. Let's take a look at it now.
My name is Sefton Delmer, and I was the first newspaper man to interview Adolf Hitler in 1932. Churchill on the War Cabinet got me thinking about creating a fake radio program to help bring down Hitler. As we began to spread confusion, our trickery led to an astonishing truth. There were Germans inside Germany, hell-bent on destroying Hitler and the Nazi regime. One of them was a pastor named Dietrich Bonhoeffer.
It is only by living completely in this world that one learns to have faith.
Bonhoeffer's work brought the ethical challenges of the resistance into focus.
Is it allowed to kill the head of state?
Do you preserve your innocence and therefore incur the guilt of doing nothing?
And he almost escaped in Schönberg with the others.
Inspiring story, Come Before Winter. We have the director, Kevin Ekvall, here, and Bonhoeffer expert, Jeff Gang. I just want to clarify something. This is going to be a special this Sabbath at the University Church during the Vespers time, but it is not going to be seen on LLBN. You have to go to the church and be a part of that program. And yeah, it's good for you to get out of the house and meet your old friends and to view this terrific story. This is awe-inspiring. And Jeff, you mentioned that he was part of the underground. What does that mean? Did he go out and assassinate troops, or did he, was a freedom fighter? What did he do?
No, he was a part of a network of Germans that were opposed to Hitler. They were both mostly the part of the army, and they, most of them were upper middle class, and there was just a small group of them, and they had been planning for quite some time how they could defeat Hitler, take Hitler out, and they could somehow work with the Allies. And so they brought Bonhoeffer in because of his connections in the ecumenical community, and they had him bring messages over to Sweden, to Norway, to try to get messages over to Britain and the United States to try to communicate that there actually was a group of Germans that were trying to resist Hitler and were plotting to take him out. And so one of the big questions that scholars have is, what role did Bonhoeffer play? Because he was, many people believe he was a pacifist. I tend to think he was a conscious objector, for sure. And there's some who say that Bonhoeffer would never be a part of a plot to kill Hitler, and there are others who say that he very much was. And this is the wrestling that you see in the film, which is excellent, by the way, and I really encourage people to come out and see it. Kevin and his team, and they've just done a really marvelous job in a really creative way to tell this dramatic story. And also other characters in the story that Bonhoeffer experienced while he was in prison, too, which are an intriguing cast of characters. It's really remarkable.
Well, you mentioned something that piqued my interest, and you know, this was almost like a Protestant church-led movement. Mm-hmm. You know, so
yeah.
you turned a world war into a religious war within a war.
Yeah,
kind of sounds like it. You know, that's the resistance.
Mm-hmm.
How did you capture that and portray that, Kevin?
Yeah, well, from the beginning, we wanted to make sure that people understood that Dietrich Bonhoeffer was part of a larger group. Mm-hmm. There were other very incredible characters that deserve their own films. We were, again, only focused on the last part of his life. And so we had to use flashbacks to kind of go back and help people understand that this was a long journey. They had come quite close in 1938, in 1943, other times to assassinating Hitler, and also a full-blown coup to take over, because it wasn't enough to just assassinate Hitler. They had to actually use the army to take over the country. So we used flashbacks a lot to kind of set the context and help people understand where we were. And we tried as much as possible to tell some of share some of the significance of these other resistors who were with Bonhoeffer along the way. So I think those were a couple of the focuses that we had when we were looking at the resistance.
Let me ask you a behind-the-scenes question. I mean, the locations are fabulous. Are they authentic?
Yeah. They are. Mm-hmm. Well, I should say we filmed in Germany and the UK twice. Two different trips, we hit both countries. But then the scenes that you see indoors are sets that we built here in the Loma Linda, Redlands, San Bernardino area. Mm. But the locations, when you're seeing anything outdoors, exteriors, those are actual locations.
Did you actually shoot on location at Flossenbürg, the concentration camp?
We did, yes. Yeah. So the concentration camp where Bonhoeffer was hanged, it is one of the locations featured at the end of the film. But then other places too, Buchenwald concentration camp and others. And so one of the tricks that we had was to make sure that the indoors and the outdoors meshed, you know? So we had to make sure that what we were filming, the real locations matched indoors. And so that presented, of course, some challenges creatively. And sometimes we're even trying to match exteriors. And one of the maybe interesting tidbits for people who live in Loma Linda is Flossenbürg, the buildings are kind of an off-white. And we shot there. But then we needed to actually shoot something with our actor who plays the part of Dietrich Bonhoeffer here in California, because it wasn't economical to take him out there. And we actually ended up using the building where a school of public health and allied health are as a part of, that's and we had to splice it together to make it work.
Yeah. Magic of television, isn't it?
Yeah.
or the movies is in this case. How long is your production?
It ends up being about, I think, an hour and 13 minutes.
Yeah. So you were at these concentration camps, or this is particularly the spot where Bonhoeffer met his untimely end. What did that do to your spine?
Well, you know, when I was first filming there, it was tough because, the wind's blowing, it's very cold, and we're trying to get things done, trying to envision what we're going to need for the final product. And so it's actually hard to emotionally kind of absorb the location, and you kind of as you're working hard, you're wishing that you could do that, and so, you know, towards the end though, I was able to take a little bit of time and to kind of reflect a bit, and you know, after we got a number of shots done, kind of things kind of eased up a bit, and there's a weight to it. There's a reality that kind of sets in when you're actually there, you know. And I looked at pictures and video, or pictures of these resistors so many times during production. I actually had a bulletin board, which is featured in the film, with the pictures of a number of resistors, including Dietrich. And being in the actual location really forces you to think of these people as real guys, you know, and people with families and people with futures, you know. And, you know, thinking of Dietrich Bonhoeffer, who's only 6 years older than I am, you know, and just thinking, you know, of kind of where he was in life. He was engaged. He was kind of at the peak of his career. It was significant to think about what they gave up doing what they did.
And it's all a matter of conscience. I mean, this was not something that they just fell into and, oh no, I did it once, so I have to continue for the rest of my life. Yeah. He really believed in, you know, the freedom of conscience. And so how do you weave the spirituality of this in your story?
Yeah, well, you know, from the very beginning, our producer, Gary Blount, who's from the Minneapolis, Minnesota area, from the beginning, his vision was that this film would be something that could be shown in schools as well as churches. So we wanted it to be accessible to an audience that wasn't necessarily Christian. And that's part of, I think, the angle of the British intelligence radio station, is just that we wanted to place Bonhoeffer in actually kind of a secular context of World War II. And then as the story goes along, kind of let the viewer get to know Bonhoeffer like that radio station team would have, and get to see his Christianity play out, you know, as they would have maybe started to understand it. So, there, you know, is there a spiritual component? Very much so. But it's kind of weaved through the film in a way that hopefully kind of can reach a larger audience.
You grew up as a Christian.
I did, yeah.
Child, now you're a Christian man. You love to work for Jesus. What does Jesus mean to you?
I think Christ to me is changed. It kind of has changed over the course of my life. And I think to me, sort of an example, sort of a place that I go when I need inspiration and redemption. And I mean, I think ultimately a growing friendship too.
Mm-hmm.
But definitely, you know, definitely a process, I guess, and a journey. Mm.
Jeff, I'd ask you the same question. What does Jesus mean to you?
Jesus is everything for me.
Amen.
You know, I've devoted my life to not only being a disciple of Jesus, but to serve him. And when I see someone like Dietrich Bonhoeffer, who was so faithful to Christ in his life, that inspires me to be the same. And, you know, Bonhoeffer once said that Christ was the man for others. And Jesus was all that for me, and I tried my best to amplify that in my, you know, in my own life as well.
So what little inside tidbits can you offer about the life of Dietrich Bonhoeffer? Yeah. I mean, you've been studying him in detail. Did he have any quirks?
He spent some time at Union Theological Seminary back in the early, late 20s, and his American friends here thought he was a pompous Prussian, they called him. He was very arrogant. He was moody. Some people think he might have been depressed at times. He was a very talented musician. Then he was a deeply flawed man, but he was also deeply devoted to Jesus Christ. And so, you know, I think it reminds me we're all broken, and we're all in need of God's redemptive love and forgiveness and mercy. And so that I'd like to see that somebody, you know, he was a real person that had some rough edges, right? Mm-hmm. But it also had, his writings are just spectacular. I mean, if anyone's read the, most people know it as The Cost of Discipleship, or originally it was Discipleship or Nachfolge, which was to follow. And that's probably one of his classics. It's Life Together, about Christian community. I mean, if a small group wants to read together a book about how to do life together, read that book. And of course, Letters and Papers from Prison, which he wrote during his time in prison, which were smuggled out, letters to his fiance, letters to his family, to his best friend, Eberhard Bethge, who became his biographer. And if you want to read a really fantastic biography, I highly recommend Ferdinand Schlingensiepen's biography, which is Helmut, I believe, was one of your team on this,
mm-hmm,
and his son. And Ferdinand that's how I really came to know Bonhoeffer the first time, was back in 2010, reading, you know, I had read Discipleship years before, but reading that biography was remarkable, one of the best to date.
Complex individual.
Yeah.
Here we have a pacifist that is a member of the underground battling, you know, Nazi during the war. And,
amazing.
You know, I'm going to try to twist Kevin's arm, and because we can't show that Vesper special because of copyright issues, but maybe we can talk about it and have a special showing of Come Before Winter right here on LLBN. What do you think, Kevin? Is that a possibility?
It definitely is a possibility, yeah. Yeah, I'd like to do that.
All right, let's talk some more with Gannon.
Well, we'll certainly have to have you all back to continue this conversation. But on this note, I think time for us to be blessed by some music. Anna, what do you have to tell us about that?
That's right. We're blessed tonight to have Edino Biagi. He is an accomplished oboist, and he'll be accompanied by Julian Jensen for his music tonight. And we'll get to know Edino a little bit more after his music performance and find out more about his musical and Christian journey. But first, over to Edino and Julian for their music this evening.
Thank you.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Dinu. Could you just join us on the set? Let's get to know you a little bit more. Thanks for that beautiful piece. Dinu, summarize a little bit who you are and how you came to be here tonight.
I feel that I'm a stranger, but I am not totally a stranger. If pedigree matters, I'm a fourth generation SDA, and I was born and raised in Argentina. My father was a physician, and the Biagi family spent many years working in our church, and one of my cousins, Billy Biagi, he's one of the vice presidents of the General Conference of SDAs. But God showed me a different path. I am not a physician like most people in my family. I'm not a pastor like most people in my family. I'm a professional musician. When I was 20 years old, I won a full scholarship to study in Chicago at Roosevelt University with the principal oboe of the Chicago Symphony. His name is Alex Klein, and I studied with him. I did all my undergrad. He won a Grammy Award while he was teaching me in Chicago. I played in different orchestras there. After 5 years, I did my master's with another very known, legendary oboe teacher. His name is Humbert Lucarelli in New York City, and I also did my post-master's degree. After I finished there, I was hired by a couple of universities to be faculty. And you might ask, what am I doing here?
How did you come to California?
Yeah, that's an interesting journey. Recently, my father passed away very unexpectedly.
I'm sorry.
And you know, we all have...
How old was he?
He was 67.
That's young.
Yeah. Very unexpectedly, and I don't mean that one death is better than another, but you know, when it's unexpected, you can't brace for impact,
right,
so to speak. And after this happened, I started rethinking my whole life, the purpose of our existence. Why do we do what we do? Why do we live where we live in a specific part of the country, et cetera. And I started focusing more on family and a little bit less on professional life. So one day I was like, I think I'm gonna go to California where all my relatives are, because here I have a nice number of cousins. And that's all the family I have in America. So my cousin Walter, he would call me, Dina, what are you doing alone in New York? Hey, man, I have this career. I have this and that. And hey, think of your family. And one day I was like, this is it. I'm out. I rented a Penske truck. I loaded everything. A friend of mine was getting married. So I gave him all my furniture. I was like, OK, you're starting a family. Good luck. Have a nice life. And I just pulled on a trailer my little sports car in the back and drove all across the country, and I arrived here. Obviously, I'm not married, so I can still do that type of stuff. And things have been very, very good. Believe it or not, I've been very busy musically in here, maybe even more than on the East Coast. It was very glamorous over there, you know. I played at Lincoln Center, you know, with fantastic orchestras. But I feel that at this point, life is too short. And at this point of my life, I want to reconnect and have spend quality time with family, you know. You. We can't just spend our whole lives, I feel, spend our whole lives chasing our dreams. And what about what's important in life?
Right.
At some point in our lives, we need to stop say, stop it, stop this nonsense, and let's refocus on what's really important in life. Mm.
What impact has Christ had on your life, in your journey so far?
Everything. I mean, you might know that as a professional classical musician, it's not easy. It's not easy. Most concerts are on Friday nights and Saturdays, and I had to give up a lot of amazing, what seemed at the time, amazing opportunities to play with very famous and symphony orchestras, and at a very early age. I don't know if I have time to touch up on
Not a whole lot.
But a little sacrifice, but...
Has it been worth it?
I think so. You can ask the same to any other professional. Is it worth it? Someday we'll have a better reward than any orchestras in this world, I think so.
Amen. Amen.
That's what keeps us going, right?
That's right. Yeah, well, we look forward to hearing you in orchestras in heaven. But for now, we'll enjoy hearing you later on in this program. But for now, I guess we'll go to Gannon. What do we have lined up next?
Well, first of all, I want to say I respect your courage and your determination to meet your spiritual goals. It's not easy, as you said, but you're marching your way through, and we pray for your success and for you to find what you're seeking in life.
Thank you very much.
Well, our guest, Mark Anthony, is also a program host on one of our channels, one of our eight channels, Smart Life Style TV. He's been on it for some time. He actually produces his own program and had blessed hundreds of thousands of viewers on a weekly basis. So he's with us today, as we introduced him earlier, and we'll go to him to share with us his testimonies.
Mm-hmm. Let me tell you, this really is an upside-down world, isn't it? I mean, when you see the things that, you know, happen with Dietrich Bonhoeffer, and there's so many things that are going on in this world that are just plain nutty. I mean, are we living in an upside-down world or what? And there's some things that we can really do to get ourselves out of this upside-down world that Satan has really put this whole world into. I mean, literally, Satan has had 6,000 years to turn this whole world upside down. And one of the best things we can do is get a lot more ADD. And, of course, when I'm talking ADD, I'm not talking about the ADD that you get from kids' cereals, okay? I'm talking about godly ADD. We need more action, direction, and discernment. And, of course, action would be James 1:22, be ye not just hearers of the word, but be doers of the word. Amen? And let me tell you, I went and I've lived in that upside-down world. I used to own a casino in Las Vegas for quite a few years. And so I have been in the heart of that upside-down world. I have seen people that have lost their relationships, ruined marriages, ruined businesses, ruined people's lives, people committing suicide, you know, all from that business of the gaming and liquor and the casino business. And I was a part of that. And I just got to the point where I was like, Lord, I don't want to have any of this anymore. You know, I just got to get out of this upside down world. And so I started praying. And I'll tell you what, if you're having problems in this world, that's the where you start. You start by prayer. And let me tell you what I did. I started spending time on my knees. And let me tell you, 15 minutes a day on your knees, that is 1% of your day. And if you will just start spending 1% of your day with Christ, he'll change your life. That's just 1%. Can you imagine if you did 5% or 10% every morning? And let me tell you, I started searching. I went to different churches all over the city. I went to over 200 different churches in Las Vegas, of every denomination you can think of. I could not find a decent church. And, you know, they'd teach part of the Bible, but they wouldn't teach the whole message. And I stayed in study every day. I stayed in prayer every day. I stayed reading the Bible every day. And God was just showing me all these different things. And then, of course, I ran across the Seventh-day Adventist Church and found out that they were really teaching the whole message. And the more I studied and the more I looked at it, the more I was like, wow, there actually is a church that's out there teaching the whole message. And one of the problems that we got in the world today, which is one of the problems that Diedrich had years ago, which is even a greater problem today, is that people don't understand the Bible, they don't listen to the Bible, they don't learn what the Bible is saying, because the Bible has every bit of wisdom that you need. Doesn't the Bible say, come, let us reason together? And if we would just come, let us reason together, put all of our thoughts of what we think is right aside, and sit down and actually communicate in a logical way, we would really come to the true answers, and every single time, it's gonna come back to Christ. Just by doing that simple reasoning together. So we do need action, direction, and discernment. Action, take that action, getting closer to Christ. Direction, now this is a different type of direction I wanna share with you. This is Psalms 5:3, because most of the time people are going up and they're saying, Lord, give me direction. It's always about me, 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 me. And we've gotta turn this around and actually understand that this is a different type of direction. Psalms 5:3, my voice you shall hear in the morning, O Lord. In the morning I will direct it to you and I will look up. See, that's the kind of direction we need. We need the type of direction to Christ. And when you start directing yourself to him, then he can do mighty things in your life. Instead of this me, 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 just humble yourself and allow God to do the work. Action, direction, discernment. I can go a little bit farther. Discernment is so important. Oh, especially in these late days that we're living in. I'm gonna go a little farther. Proverbs 2, 5 through 3. This is Proverbs 2, 5 through 3. Yes, if you cry out for discernment and you lift up your voice for understanding, if you seek her as silver and search for her as hidden treasure, then you will understand the fear of the Lord and find the knowledge of God. Let me tell you, we need action, direction, and discernment. And when you get those three things together, God is going to open up your eyes and get you out of this upside-down world that we're living in now, and put you in the world that he wants you to be living in, so that you can be a mighty, mighty person in his kingdom. And it just takes steps. Just keep taking those steps. Be consistent, be persistent. And let me tell you, here's what's gonna happen. When you start praying every day, when you start reading the Bible, when you start doing these things to get yourself out of the world, I mean, shut off these TVs. Let me tell you. There, well, except Loma Linda Broadcasting, you can keep that one on. But there is so much junk on these TVs, am I right? I mean, it's just nutty out there. I mean, it's just crazy the things that are going on. And the bottom line here is when you get this action, direction, and discernment, and you really start seeing the things in a whole different light, you're gonna see some other things that are really gonna blow you away. I'm really gonna blow you away here, because Satan is in charge of hope in society. Yeah, did he just say that right? Satan's in charge of hope? Yes, this is the upside down, I gotta share this with you. This is the upside down world we live in. Now these are definitions of hope in the Bible. Okay, you gotta get this. We've got a place of refuge, safety, security, assurance is a definition of hope. So there's some good definitions of hope in the Bible. But these are also definitions of hope without care. Carelessness is a definition of hope. To attach oneself. The folly of relying upon any other type of security strongly contrasts with depending on God alone. So now we've got bipolar hope going on. One who is overconfident and shows no caution whatsoever, that's a definition of hope. And my favorite one, an expressed sense of resignation. There is nothing more one can do. Now, doesn't that sound like hopelessness? So we've got to understand there's a difference between hope being a noun, which, you know, that is Jesus Christ, and hope being a verb, which is that earthly, ungodly hope. But what Satan has done is he's bundled it all together into one big package. So, and I call it the bundling effect. He'll take all the terms and bundle it together. He says, all you need is hope, and everything's going to be fine. It's actually a form of insanity. Now, you know what insanity is, right? that's doing the same thing over and over but expecting a different result? Well, that's what people are doing with hope today. They're hoping the economy changes. They're hoping a new administration's gonna change things. They're hoping they get a job without ever looking for a job. They're hoping their health changes without ever taking that action, changing their lifestyle. It is literally a form of insanity. I mean, is there gonna be hope in heaven? No, because we're gonna have our hope fulfilled in heaven, amen? And that's the way we need to be here on earth today, is having our hope fulfilled, knowing that Jesus Christ is our Lord and Savior, not hoping he is our Lord and Savior. Are you catching the differences here? But Satan does this bundling effect. So when you have that discernment, you're gonna see these little upside down things that Satan is doing in this world. And God is gonna fill you with light. He's gonna fill you with passion to serve, passion to change. And the only one that can change yourself is Christ. You know, too many people think, well, I can change myself. Then it's all about I, and me, and all this type of thing. I mean, you know, there's one thing that there's a lot of people that think we're saved by faith, right? After all, doesn't the Bible say we are saved by faith? The point is that it's not your faith that saves you. If it was your faith that saves you, then what do you need a Savior for? The saving faith that the Bible talks about is Christ's faith, the covenant that he has with us. That is the saving faith. Of course, we need our own faith, but these are the little upside-down things that you really don't notice in the world until you receive God's discernment. Read more, study more, pray more. God will do amazing things in your life. And let me tell you, there's this story in the Bible. I got to share this one with you. Remember the vineyard who went into town to get some workers to work his field? And then he went back and got more workers, and he went back and got more workers. And then these people came in at the 11th hour. And the lesson of the story is basically that the people that come in at the 11th hour get the same reward as the people who have been there all day long, right? That's the basic lesson of the story. But there's a lot more to this. Let me tell you. I was up in Northern California late last year, and they had a massive storm coming in from the north. And they had crews out in those fields 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, getting those fields cleared, or they were going to lose all their crops. So they knew ahead of time, you know, and I'm reading these scriptures in the Bible, and I said, you know what? There's more to this story. And so as I was reading and studying more, and I'm looking at this farmer who's going into town to get more help. And let me tell you, the farmer was literally, he's a professional farmer, right? He knows exactly how many people he needs to harvest that crop. And I'm thinking about this, and I said, I'll bet you there was a storm on the horizon. And I haven't found this in the spirit of prophecy. I haven't found it in the Bible. But this is what I'm guessing, because there was an urgency to get that crop harvested. That's why he went back at the 11th hour to get more people. You know, he knew that there was a storm coming. You know, otherwise, he'd say, oh, we'll finish it up tomorrow. So there was an urgency. That's part one. Part two about this is you've got to think about the people who were looking for work all day long. They couldn't find work. And then they're like, the guy comes up and says, hey, I'll put you in the fields. I'll pay you, you know. Now, let me tell you, these people were pretty excited. They were so excited because they were not going to have to go home empty-handed to their wives. They were like, oh, man, we get to, yeah, we're going to make something to take home. And they were going out there, and they were just picking up those grapes, and they were running back and going and getting another bushel. And they were so excited. They were just running through those fields and those vineyards. And the people that were working there all day actually stopped working. They looked around dumbfounded, like, what are these people doing? That's where we're at today. Who are you going to be? Are you going to be the person that's so excited that Christ is right here? He's on his way. Or are you going to be the person sitting there doing nothing, dumbfounded, just watching everything go by? And this is all about character. What type of character, what type of passion do you have? In the book called Counsels on Living, Ellen White says that they were paid based on their spirit. And that's my question. What type of spirit do you have? Do you have a passion? Or are you so wrapped up in this upside down world that you need to get out of? Let me tell you, God has a world way beyond anything you could possibly imagine. Even right here, right now, he will do amazing things in your life. So I pray that you will take that time, read more, study more, pray more, take that action, pray for discernment, direct yourself to him so he can do mighty, mighty things in your life. Amen? Amen.
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 Thank you, Chef Anthony, for this very exciting message. You know, we all need to be a little excited about Christ's second coming.
Give you something to think about now, huh? Well,
he is coming.
Yeah, amen.
He is coming indeed. It's just a matter of time. And the question is, I've always wrestled with that since I was a little child. Is it going to be my lifetime or my children's lifetime or 50 generations from now? Either way, we have to be ready because it could be a surprise. It could be a surprise. Are you always this excited?
Hey, I'm just excited about serving the Lord. You know, I came into the church. I got baptized about 9 years ago.
Oh, is that right?
And I actually grew up Catholic. I grew up in a Catholic family and went to church every Sunday. We were Catholics 1 hour a week. Mm. You know, and then I never ever ran across anybody from church ever after that 1 hour.
Yeah, believe me, though, there's Seventh-day Adventists or Seventh-day Adventists 1 hour a week,
too. Yeah, I used to be an altar boy, too, until I got taller than the priest, and then they had to get somebody shorter. But, just by reading and studying and doing homework and really praying a lot, you got baptized, and God's been using me ever since. But I'm like Isaiah 6:8, you know, I'm like, send me, I'll go.
But you surrendered yourself to Christ, obviously. Yeah. You know, God doesn't make us do anything.
Mm-hmm.
We have the rest of it with us. We have to have the desire and the will to submit and to do the work. As you're working on the movie that you're producing and what you're doing and everyone else here is doing. How did your conversion happen to accepting Christ? Obviously, you've always been Christian. You've always knew there's a heavenly God and there is Christ. But when did you really have that personal relationship?
Really, God put the passion in my heart.
Hmm.
To get out of that nightmare of the casino business. And I mean, there's just so many devastating things happening. And I just prayed and prayed and I said, Lord, you've got, you know, better plans. What do you want me to do? And you know, we have to have obedience. That's one of the biggest things, you know. A lot of people are not obedient. And you know, look at the word listen. One of the definitions of the word listen is actually obedience. You see, there's a lot of people listening to God with their ears, but they're not listening to God with their actions, doing what God is asking them to do. And when you really get that understanding that God has your best interests in mind, and you start literally listening to him with obedience, then he will show you amazing, amazing things.
That comes from that relationship.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, obedience.
And it takes time.
Yeah. You had to walk the walk with him to get to know him. Yeah. But, you know, it's interesting. You mentioned the word casino. I didn't know anything about your background. Were you physically in the business?
Yeah, I owned one.
Oh, is that right? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, for quite a few years there.
And
slot
machines.
And what happened? Is it your conversion got you out of it, or were there some drastic circumstances?
Just seeing all the devastations. I mean, it's amazing. I mean, one lady, she used to just swipe her credit cards all the time on those slot machines, I never thought nothing about it, you know. And then I find her with a bullet in her head, you know, committing suicide, you know, and orphaning three kids.
Wow.
You know, and I'm like, Lord, I don't want to be a part of this. I don't want to be a part of it.
How often we're in the world and we don't realize the consequences of our actions. Mm-hmm. You know, many of us are lucky enough to grow out of it and learn before we cause any further harm. Yeah. Sounds like you really went through a very emotional and drastic experience.
I still do. I mean, you know, years later. You know, God can take the worst situation that you're ever in and turn it into something better.
Amen.
It doesn't matter how bad your situation is, what's going on in your life, He can change and make the into something better.
You know what, I like people like you who is free through Christ, where they can speak of these things freely, mm-hmm. and not live in hiding, ashamed of what they have done, because what we have done, we can't control anymore. It's beyond us. It's what we do next, how are we going to move forward. And I really appreciate that spirit of determination. You know, you're not, yeah. you're moving forward, but also you're acknowledging the mistakes of the past.
Well, Christ is my refuge, and He's what keeps me protected and keeps me safe and does those things that nobody or anything in this world could ever do. And when you get in that comfort zone, I mean, that's true comfort. Mm-hmm. You know, a lot of people think they're in their comfort zone and in their little worlds.
Right.
That is nothing. I had the comfort zone. I mean, I could buy anything I wanted to buy. You know, I mean, sometimes we were pulling $20,000 a week out of a slot machine. You know, they make a lot of money. And, you know, but that was not comfort for me. And the only place I find comfort is in the Lord's hands.
But at the time, you probably thought it was comfort.
Yeah, oh, yeah.
Right?
Yeah, you're completely blinded. You're completely in this upside-down world, yes. and you have no idea.
Yeah, because I was out in the world, as many of us could have been there. Mm-hmm. We thought that's the joy of life until we step out of it. And then we look back in retrospect, what a disaster. Mm-hmm. I don't know how we considered that joy at that time. Yeah.
And then he took it even one step farther. He got me healthy. Because I was like 325 pounds. I've already lost 75 pounds.
Is that right?
Yeah, going on a healthier lifestyle. And being a chef, that's what my trade was, a chef. And now I go all over the country teaching people how to eat healthy. Because the bottom line is, when you're healthier physically, you're going to be healthier mentally. And then you're going to have a better connection with God.
Very true.
And one of my bigger problems, I think, was that I was not healthy. So to get a better connection with God is amazing.
I can also connect with that, because my health was going downhill. I became diabetic because of my health and lifestyle until I made a turnaround toward Jesus, mm-hmm. which He not only restored me spiritually, but also He restored me physically
exactly.
as well.
It's like He returns all those years.
Now I feel younger than when I
yeah.
was younger.
Yeah.
So go figure. That's how God works. Well, we're almost out of time on this segment. We're going to come back some more. But what you have just said about your ministry to go out and teach people how to be healthy, mm-hmm. you're actually doing that through Smart Lifestyle TV,
mm-hmm, yes.
which is one of LLBN channels dedicated as a public service to viewers around the world to help them live better, healthier mm-hmm. life. And thank you for your contribution on that channel.
Thank you.
Stay with us. We're going to come back. I think Hannah, for right now, is going to take it back to some music.
All right, we're going to go back to Dino Biagi and Julian Jensen for the next piece for us this evening. Over to you guys.
Thank you.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Amen. Thank you. Well, folks, I guess we have less time than I thought left for the remainder of the program. We thank you all for being with us today. We hope for all of you who are local to come back and join us again. You are in Loma Linda now, right?
Right now, yes.
Okay, well, we need to take advantage of that, Hannah. Any last words any of you like to add here today to your message to our viewers?
Thanks for the work you all do, and I wish God's mercies on you this new year and many blessings and success in what you do.
Thank you.
Good to be back.
Thank you. Love to have you back. It's been a while, actually.
Yeah, it has.
But just today, I learned that you're in the area closer than I thought,
yeah.
Right here on the campus of Loma Linda.
Yeah.
Thank you. Kevin?
Yeah, thank you for all your hard work. I'm usually behind the camera, so I know how much goes into all of that. And usually the final product is just a tip of the iceberg. So, yeah, thanks. Thanks for your hard work.
Well, it takes a team, right?
It's
taken a whole family to keep this ministry on the air for over 20 years. And I'm just amazed how it keeps growing. It started with one channel. It started with 3 hours of programming a week. And now we have 8 channels running. 3 in English and 5 foreign. That's only a testimony to God's power, to what he can do out of, how much he can do out of nothing. It's almost like the story of the fish and the loaves. Any words you'd like to share with our viewers?
Well, you
health
know,
tip?
yeah, it does take a team, and it does take a lot of people. And I just pray that everybody out there will create their own passion to serve, and rather it be, I mean, partaker of the ministry that is going on right here.
That's correct.
Or maybe it's your own church, or, you know, just take action and do something, because time is so short, and we just need to finish the work so I can go home, so we can all go home. That's what I want.
Well, just remember the story of the talents that Jesus, the parable he gave.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you can either do something with your talents, or just sit on it and do nothing, mm-hmm. and you'll serve no purpose.
Yeah.
So step forward, serve your community, serve those around you, get involved in any ministry you can, especially your own local churches.
Yeah, and God will bless you for it. You know,
many times.
Anytime
over,
I've ever seen somebody who does not volunteer, the minute they start volunteering,
things change.
Thinking they're doing it for somebody else, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. they end up getting the blessing. They end up receiving such a feeling of joy in their hearts that is priceless.
Very true. Any words you'd like to share with our viewers?
Basically, two things. The first one, thank you for having me.
Of course, it's
and,
our pleasure.
And I've performed in a few places throughout my career, and also in a few TV stations, and I do know the hard work that goes and the logistics and everything viewers don't see that goes on behind the scenes, so I wanted to tell you to not to get discouraged, to continue moving forward, that I see that God is blessing your ministry. And the second thing is that to the viewers, to focus on what's important in life, family.
Amen.
And not to wait for that phone call or that email.
We're out of time, unfortunately. We'll see you here next week on Christian Connections.